Good to be in the house of the Lord. Let's begin the service this morning by standing together with our hymnals and turning to number 167 as we sing "All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name." Number 167. Turn ahead with me to number 227. 227, Saved by the Blood.
Great price of his Christ's pardon, picked from precious Son.
Save the blood
of the crucified one. My sins are all pardoned, my guilt is all gone. I'm saved by the blood of the crucified one. Saved by the blood of the crucified one. All hail to the Father, all hail to the Son, all hail to the Spirit, the great three in one. Saved by the blood of the crucified one.
Take our Bibles at this time for our memory verse. And turn with me to the book of Psalms. Psalms chapter 27 and verse 5. Psalms chapter 27 and verse 5. Excuse me, verse 5. Okay, let's begin as we repeat our verse four times. Psalms chapter 27, verse 5. For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me up upon a rock. Psalms chapter 27, verse 5. For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me up upon a rock. Psalms chapter 27, verse 5. For in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his tabernacle. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me upon a rock. Psalms chapter 27, verse 5. For in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me up upon a rock.
Let's bow our heads and open in prayer. Heavenly merciful Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for a good full house. Thank you for our church to come to hear your word preached. And Lord, we pray you empower pastor to teach us, to feed us, to strengthen us, and encourage us. We thank you and we pray for these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And now we'll have a special.
Yeah.
been told, and I believe it's true. He's preparing me a place that I cannot comprehend. How much more does he love me and you? How much more than a fragrant rose that he gives life in the spring?
And boys and girls are dismissed to junior church. And if you take your Bible, please, and find the book of Luke, chapter 23. Luke, chapter 23. And we'll be looking at a couple portions of scripture this morning. Luke, chapter 23. And then you can turn ahead to John, chapter 18. So Luke, chapter 23. So delighted to have visitors and honored guests and our special church family. Thank you for each of you out this morning. Remember to pray for those who are away from us on holidays and traveling, those who are ill. And may the Lord add the blessing of the reading of his word this morning. So if you get the setting here, found in all four of the Gospels, you find Jesus before Pilate. And Pilate, knowing that the Jews had sold Jesus into their hands because of envy. And Pilate, when he had called together the chief priest, reading Luke 23, verse 13, and the rulers of the people, said unto them, "You have brought this man unto me as one that perverteth the people, and behold, I've examined him before you, have found no fault in this man, touching those things whereof you accused him. No, nor yet Herod, for I sent you to him, and lo, nothing worthy of death is done unto him." Notice the corrupt heart of Pilate. "I will therefore chasten him and release him." Why would you do that to an innocent man? "For of necessity he must release one unto them at the feast." And they cried out all at once, saying, "Away with this man, and release unto us Barabbas, who for certain sedition made in the city for murder was cast into prison." Now just think about this. Here is a murderer. The people are calling for him to be released and calling for the blood of Jesus. Pilate, therefore, willing to release Jesus, spake again to them. But they cried, saying, "Crucify, crucify him." And he said unto them the third time, "Why, what evil has he done? I found no cause of death in him. I will therefore chasten him and let him go." And they were insistent with loud voices, requiring that he might be crucified. And the voices of them and the chief priests prevailed. And Pilate gave sentence that it should be as they required. And he released unto them him, now notice this is the second time we find this phrase, for sedition and murder was cast in the prison, whom they had desired, but he delivered Jesus to their will. John 18, please. Verse 37, and then we'll read into chapter 19. John 18, 37, Pilate therefore said to him, art thou a king then? Jesus answered, thou sayest that I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice. Pilate said to him, what is truth? When he had said this, he went out again unto the Jews and saith unto them, I find in him no fault. But ye have a custom that I should release unto you one at the Passover. Will ye therefore that I release unto you the king of the Jews? Then cried they again, saying, not this man, but Barabbas. Now Barabbas was a robber. So he's a murderer and a robber. Then Pilate therefore took Jesus and scourged him. Means he whipped him. And the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they put on him a purple robe. Now what they're doing is they're mocking the Lord. And so said, hail, King of the Jews. And they smote him with their hands. Pilate therefore went forth again and said to them, behold, I bring him forth to you, that ye may know that I find no fault in him. Then came Jesus forth, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. And Pilate said unto them, behold, the man. When the chief priests therefore and officers saw him, they cried out, saying, crucify, crucify. Pilate said unto them, take ye him and crucify, for I find no fault in him. The Jews answered him, we have a law, and by our law he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God. He is the matchless Son of God. When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he was the more afraid. Went again in the judgment hall and said unto Jesus, whence art thou? But Jesus gave him no answer. Then said Pilate unto him, speakest thou not unto me? Knowest not that I have power to crucify thee and have power to release thee? Jesus answered, thou couldst have no power at all against me, except it were given thee from above. Therefore, he that delivered me unto thee hath the greater sin. And from henceforth Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, saying, if thou let this man go, thou art not Caesar's friend. Whosoever maketh himself a king speaketh against Caesar. When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus forth and sat down in the judgment seat in the place that is called the pavement, but in the Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was the preparation of the Passover about the sixth hour. And Satan to the Jews, behold your king. But they cried out, away with, crucify him. Pilate said unto them, shall I crucify your king? The chief priests answered, we have no king but Caesar. Then delivered he therefore unto them to be crucified, and they took Jesus and led him away. And Father, the scene before us this morning, we could go through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all four of the Gospels, and see this Roman leader by the name of Pilate, as he was being condemned before the Gentiles and before the Jews. Interesting, Pilate says, I find in him no fault. Father, I pray now that you will take the word of God and speak into our hearts and souls. I pray, O God, that we might see that too many fault is found in Jesus. But to you and those who have received him as their Savior, they could say, I find in him no fault. Now bless the preaching of your word. Help me as I preach in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like you to turn over to Matthew chapter 27. Matthew chapter 27. We find also the report of the saying of finding fault in Jesus. First of all, in Matthew chapter 27 and verse number 1 through 4, we find Judas. Who is Judas? Who is this man Judas? Well, hard to comprehend, but he was a disciple, a follower of the Lord. And yet, just like many in the church house appear to be followers of the Lord, they have false professions in their lives in the matter of Christ. They appear outwardly to be righteous and faithful, but inwardly, just like Jesus said to the religious group, inwardly dead bones, dead sepulchers. So Pilate now is going to get a letter from his wife. Judas is actually going to give a testimony about the one who he betrayed and sold for 30 pieces of silver. When the morning was come, Matthew 27, 1, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus. Now, this wasn't a Bible, it'd be hard to believe, to put him to death. Jesus, he who knew no sin, he who raised the dead, caused the blind to see, the leper to be healed, the lame to walk, the blind to see, the deaf to hear, the dumb to speak, and yet they're wanting to put him to death. When they had bound him, now think about that, binding those lovely healing hands. They led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. Then here he is. Then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself. Well, does that mean he got saved? No, just sorry that he got found out. And brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have sinned. You know, there are several people in the Bible said that they sinned, but they didn't get right with God. They just announced the fact that they were sinners, but not repent of their sin and turn to Christ. I have sinned that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And they say, notice the cruelty of the heart of the religious people. What is that to us? See thou to that. And he cast down the pieces of silver in the temple, and departed and went, and hanged himself. Now look with me. Pilate's wife, who history tells us became a Christian. Verse 19. Verse 18 says, Pilate knew why they delivered Jesus. Verse 17 says, therefore, when they were gathered together, Pilate said to them, whom will ye that I release unto you, Barabbas or Jesus, which is called Christ? For he, now think about Pilate, for he knew that for envy they had delivered him. When he was set down on the judgment seat, his wife sent unto him, saying, have thou nothing to do with this man? So think about this. Pilate is sitting at the judgment seat, going to pronounce judgment to Jesus, and a messenger brings a note. Pilate opens the note, begins to read these words. Have thou nothing to do with this just man? I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him. But the chief priests and elders persuaded the multitudes that they should ask Barabbas and destroy Jesus. Now, jump down to verse 23. And the governor said, why? What evil hath he done? But they cried out the more, saying, let him be crucified. Now, notice Pilate. When Pilate saw that he prevailed nothing, but rather a tumult was made, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See you to it. Then answered all the people. Now think about history. Think about the history of the Jews for 2,000 years. Then answered all the people, that's referring to the Jews, and said, his blood be upon us and upon our children. And for 2,000 years, the Jews have suffered horribly because they denounced the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, over and over in our text, we find the words, I find no fault in him. That is my text, and that is my title. I find no fault in him. Many people find fault in Jesus. First of all, they find fault in his salvation. Look with me, if you will, of course, if you're in Matthew now, go up to John chapter 3. First of all, I would say to you, I find fault in the Buddhist religion. I find fault into Shintoism. I find fault in all religions. Religion is man-made. No Baptist can get you to heaven. You're visiting maybe for the first time this morning a Baptist church. This church can't get you to heaven. Buddha can't get you to heaven. Allah can't get you to heaven. The Mormons can't get you to heaven. The Seventh-day Adventists can't get you to heaven. The Campbellites can't get you to heaven. The Presbyterians can't get you to heaven. The Methodists can't get you to heaven. The Baptists can't get you to heaven. There's only one way to get into heaven. For I find fault in every religion, but I find no fault in Christianity. John chapter 3. John 3, so familiar to us, and yet we often overlook it. John 3, 14. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Why was the serpent lifted up in Numbers 21? Because the Israelites were complaining against Moses and his leadership and against God. And because of that, they complained about the way. They complained about the food. They complained and criticized. And God sent fiery serpents to bite the people of God. And they were bitten. And the venom and the snakes were taking their lives. And finally, the people cried out to Moses for deliverance. And Moses cried out to God. And God said, make a serpent of brass. Brass in the Bible speaks of judgment. And take that serpent and put it on a pole. And when the people look, they shall live. And so, in the matter of the snake being the death to the people, a man was the death to all of us in the matter of sin, and his name was Adam. Because Adam sinned, all mankind has been born into sin, and we have a sin nature. So Jesus is giving a picture here to the most religious man in his day, Nicodemus, who is a ruler of the Jews, who came to Jesus in the nighttime hour and said, sir, we know that thou art a teacher sent from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Now he gave him a compliment. How do you take compliments? Well, Jesus looked him in the eyes and said, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And verse 14 now, as remember, this is Nicodemus standing before the Lord. And Jesus said to him in verse 3, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man is born again, he shall not see the kingdom of heaven. In verse 14, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so, now watch the words, must the Son of Man be lifted up. That whosoever, I like that whosoever, that whosoever is how I got in. That whosoever is how anybody can get in. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish. People don't have to go to hell. God didn't make hell for mankind. God made hell for the devil and his demons. But those like the Israelites, who said, let his blood be upon our head and upon our children, are walking over the blood of the shed blood of the precious Son of God. Know ye not, Peter writes, that you are not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold received by the traditions of your father, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb, without blemish, without spot. I find no fault in his blood. I find no fault in his life. I find no fault in his living. So God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not, verse 17, his Son in the world, notice, God sent not his Son in the world to condemn the world. He did not come to condemn, but he is coming, beloved, to judge. He's coming to judge the world of sin and righteousness and judgment. And God sent his Son, and God sent the Holy Spirit to convict the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment. And Jesus is coming. And when he comes, beloved, he's coming to take up the saints to glory and bring judgment upon the earth. Seven horrible, unbelievable, destructive years of destruction called the tribulation. And we need to be mindful of that. So I find no fault in his salvation. How about you? For God sent not his Son in the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Verse 18, two kind of people in the world. He that believeth is not condemned. He that believeth not, condemned already. Think about that. Find Acts chapter 4. Think about that. Condemned already. Everybody that we rub shoulders with and see. New neighbor moved into our community. somehow, his mail came in my mailbox. 332, I'm 224. He's 332. There's a difference and a distinction. So the Lord allowed me yesterday to walk to his home and hand him the letter. And then the Lord allowed me, secondly, to hand him another letter. And he said, so I asked the question. I said, by the way, I said, I'm your neighbor, but I'm also the neighborhood priest. Think about that when you're doing nothing. I'm a Catholic priest. The word Catholic means universal and the priesthood of the believer. So I said, I'm your neighbor preacher. I didn't say priest. And I said, I have a little devotional for you. And he started stuttering and said, I have to talk to my wife. I can't believe over the years how many men say I have to talk to my wife. And the matter was, so I said, we have some Filipino, by the way, he's Filipino. Two handsome Filipino boys. I said, would you like to send your boys to Sunday school? We work all the time. I said, not a problem. I'm your neighbor. I will pick them up. But anyway, long story short, I gave him a devotional. I gave him his letter, gave him a letter that he did not anticipate. I hope he finds no fault. I hope he'll read that. I pray that he'll discuss with his wife, and then I'll show up again, kindly and lovingly, and say, so what do you think? But now Acts 4, I love this verse. Acts chapter 4. By the way, what am I doing this morning? I'm preaching the Bible. Thank the Lord we have a book, amen? A blessed book, a supernatural book, an eternal book, a preserved book, an infallible book. That means I can preach it without compromise. An errant book, there's no errors in it. If you find an error in the Bible, you are the error. There is no errors in the Bible, beloved. Now verse 12, look at this. Look at this verse. I find no fault in his salvation. And a long time ago, before most of you were born, as a 16-year-old teenager, I received him as my Savior. And all these many years, I wish I could say I lived a faithful life for the Lord, but I cannot say that. Because in my life are wasted years, years that I wasted away. Young people, do not come to the place in your mind when you say, you know, I'm going to enjoy myself. I'm going to eat and drink and be married and enjoy myself. And when I'm older, once I've had my fling, I will come to Christ. You cannot say that, beloved. You cannot say that. Boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what day will bring forth. Now notice Acts 4. Here's Peter, the impetuous fisherman. Here's Peter, who denied the Lord by cursing. You know, cursing should never be in the lips of a Christian. Can you imagine a Christian taking God's name in vain? Can you imagine a Christian taking Jesus' name in vain? And by the way, one of the names, if a person ever takes it, there is no salvation available for them. And that is rejecting the wooing of the Holy Spirit and the matter of conviction and salvation. If you reject the wooing of the Holy Spirit to convict our hearts with salvation, and you reject it, beloved, you pass the line. And that line of embarkation, you cannot come back. Neither is your salvation in any other. Again, I'm not being unkind. Baptist, Presbyterian, Pentecost, Lutherans, Catholics, Mormons, Muslims, doesn't matter. Neither is there salvation any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. 2 Corinthians 5, Now you can say, you know, this is elementary to me. I'm already a Christian, and so am I. But I never, ever want to get over my salvation. I never, ever want to say, you know, back years ago, I got saved. Every day, I thank him for my salvation. Every day, I thank him for calling me to preach. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For he, God, hath made him, Jesus, sin for us. If you notice, when I read through the gospel, there's some verses I didn't read. They're on a slant. They're called italicized verses. That means they were added by the translators. And sometimes when you read those verses, they mess you up. For he hath made him sin for us. Sin for us. Who knew no sin. My goodness. I find no fault in his blood. On 2015, at the Fort McMurray Hospital, I was bleeding out. I'd had colon cancer surgery. The staples had come out. I was bleeding out. I was laying on a stretcher for hours, and I was bleeding out. And finally, there came a nurse or someone said, this guy's dying. And they ushered my wife and son out of the room, and I was gone. And then I heard some voices as someone was running around with some blood looking for the room that I was in. And by the mercy of God and by the grace of God, I'm still here. Thank God to somebody's blood. That blood. I don't know about that blood. I don't know who the person was who gave that blood. But I do know this. After I was given that blood, I've had a great desire to eat rice. So I don't know who gave the blood, but thank the Lord I'm still here. So excuse me for a little bit of satire there, but I thought I would just lay that out there. I visited someone's home yesterday, and they said, we're having rice. I said, I like rice. So I do like rice. And in fact, my famous Chinese meal is beef fried rice, no MSG, no soy sauce, no onions. That's me, cheap date. So, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. I find no fault in his salvation. Something else, beloved. Something else I want you to think about. Find the biggest book of the Bible. The biggest book of the Bible. What book would that be, preacher? Psalms. Psalms. 150 chapters. Find Psalms 119, the largest chapter in the Bible. Now, you know, I've heard preachers, and I've said it myself. You know, nothing ever occurs to God, but something occurred to me this morning, early this morning. And that is, if I say to you, you ought to read your Bible. What does that depict to you? Oh my goodness, is he nuts? Look how big this thing is. And I bet you people are overwhelmed when a preacher said, you ought to read your Bible. Well, that's a big book. If you go to the store, by the way, Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the Father. That's another thing. You know, bread makes me fat. I can't have gluten. I love gluten. I could eat bread every day of the world. But now I have to have something called bread, but in bread. But if you have a loaf of bread, and I know some here, you'd eat the whole loaf. But you don't eat the whole loaf. You eat one slice at a time. If you had a cake, and I know someone here this morning does not like frosting on cake. Now, I don't know why you don't like frosting on cake, but some people don't like frosting on cake. You know, you can always tell when I've had ice cream. You know how you can tell? Two places, my mouth and my shirt. I even put a bib on. Somehow it reaches there. But if I say, would you like a piece of cake? And I give you a piece of cake, do you put the whole thing in your mouth? Some do. But basically, you take a little piece. And if you're dainty, you do like one of these. Now, I have little fingers, so it's hard. I can't do that anyway. So So if you're dainty, you just take a little piece. Nothing wrong with being dainty. But you don't eat the whole cake. So if I say to you, read the Bible, it's overwhelming. And that's why I believe some, and I say this very tenderly and kindly, some are overwhelmed with reading the Bible. Well, where do I read? Well, can I give you some information this morning that I believe will help us? If Jesus said, man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of the Father. And so we look at this book, it's 66 books, yet it's one book. It fits like a glove. Now, how did we all come about? How did we all come about? Well, you know how you came about. You used to be slime. You were slime. And you came out of the ocean, and you went from being slime and having fins to having feet. And then you went from having feet to having a long tail. And then you went from having a long tail and feet to having two arms. So you get that. That's called evolution. Well, if evolution is happening, why am I still shaving? But the Bible tells us, in the beginning, God. That's found in the book of Genesis. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Do you like history? I like history. From the book of Joshua all the way to the book of Esther, you find the history of the Jews and Gentiles. How many of you like music? You like music? Well, God wrote the biggest book in the Bible, and it's all about music and emotions, the book of Psalms. So in Psalms 119, verse 160, we'll just turn there, by the way. The only book in all the Bible that actually has chapters is the book of Psalms. Psalms is divided in 22 stanzas. 22 stanzas of 8. The beginning of each stanza is a letter from the 22 word letters from the Hebrew alphabet. So we'll just take a small portion here, getting a little piece. Now, how many of you like history? Again, Joshua to Esther. How many of you like Psalms and poetry? You like poetry? Well, you have the book of Psalms and the book of Proverbs and the book of Ecclesiastes. And how many of you like love stories? You have the Song of Solomon. And how many of you like to know about the history? Well, to know about the history, you have 17 prophets, beginning with the major prophets, going down to the minor prophets. How many of you would like to know more about Jesus? More about Jesus. I mean, would you really like to know more about Jesus? You have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you can see Jesus' life. And then if you like history of the New Testament, there's only one history book, and that is the book of Acts. And then how would you like to know how to keep your marriage running? Well, you have the book of Ephesians and so forth. How would you like to know how to take care of your money and money matters? You have 1st and 2nd Corinthians. How would you like to know about the future? You have the book of the Revelation. So you get the idea? So if you take little bites of the Bible, let's say you're going through emotions. You're having a time of depression. You're having a time of dismay and doubt, and you're full of discouragement. Something happened at work, something happened at school, something happened in your home, something happened in church, and you're really feeling depressed, and you're feeling all alone. Well, Psalms 119, notice if you will, verse 160. Psalms 119, verse 160. Go with me, please. Thy word is true from the beginning, and every word of thy righteous judgments endureth forever. Psalms 161. Princes have persecuted me while the cause, but my heart standeth in awe of what class? Thy word. I rejoice at thy word as one that findeth great spoil. Verse 165. Great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. Now, Psalms 27, our memory verse. Just look at that for a moment. Well, before we go there, Psalms 91. Psalms 91. Preacher, how many points to this message? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We're now at point two, though, so we're moving along. So, emotions. Do men have emotions? I hope so. And by the way, fellas, the older you get, you cry a little bit more. If you don't cry, when you get older, you cry a little bit more. And I know what it is about, but I guess, I don't know, but you cry a little bit. So when we think about emotions, and we think about dark places and deep places. So keep your finger in Psalms 91, and let's go to our memory verse and see why I selected that for this week. So we'll read it first. Psalms 27, verse 5. For in times of trouble, anybody have any trouble? If you're living, you have troubles. You have financial troubles, physical troubles, family problems, work problems, school problems. If you're living, you have problems. You have troubles. And for in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. Wouldn't it be wonderful if when you were going through troubles, there was a place you could flee to? I know a place you can flee to when you're having troubles. It's spelled with five letters. C-H-U-R-C-H. Is that how you spell it? Church house. We come to the church house to hear the word of God, to be encouraged. We hear good singing. Thank you, girls. We hear congregational singing, an opportunity for you to sing unto the Lord. And so we thank the Lord we have a hiding place. Now, do you have a hiding place in your home? Do you have a secret place? Do you have a special place where you go and you take a little bite from the Word of God? Let God speak to your heart and you speak back to Him. For in the time of trouble, He shall hide in His pavilion in the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. That word tabernacle means a tent. And he shall set me upon a rock. Now Psalms 91. Psalms 91. If you get nothing this morning from the message, would you get the importance of the blood of Jesus Christ to save our souls? Would you get the importance of the scriptures to change and challenge and correct and comfort our hearts? He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, watch it now, he's my refuge. Now in Bible times, they had to make cities of refuge. Those cities of refuge were places where if, let's say, you were out chopping down a tree, I don't know why you'd be doing that, but in Bible times, you might be doing that. And you're chopping down the tree. And while you're chopping down the tree, you're chopping it down with your best friend. He's over there chopping down a tree. And as you're chopping that tree, the axe head comes out off and kills your friend. Now your friend has a hot-hearted brother. Hard-headed is what I want to say. Hot-headed. And because of that, he's going to kill you. Even though you're innocent, even though you didn't mean to kill your friend, he's your friend. Or if he was a stranger chopping in the forest and he died by your axe head, that she did not prematurely desire to kill that person. Now, again, that fella has a hot-headed brother or uncle or father going to come kill you. So in Bible times, God made a way and made little cities called cities of refuge. And you could go to those cities and hide. And while you're in those cities, they would find out, was this an accident? Was this prematurely murder? Or was this simply an accident? And rather than losing your life because you're innocent, there was a place of refuge. Well, I thank the Lord this morning. I have a place of refuge. Now, I don't say this to be unkind, but man will fail you because they're man. Jesus said in John 2:25, He did not put his confidence in man because he knew it was a man. And man is weak. We're weak. And when you begin to look to man to be your strength, to be your source and your supply, well, man will fail you because they're man. But he will never fail us. He's our refuge, notice, and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Surely he should deliver thee from the snare of the fowler. And that would be, of course, an animal being caught in a trap. We have a fowler. His name is Satan. And his design is to wreck, to ruin your home, your family, your testimony. And from noise pestilence, he shall cover thee with his feathers. Under his wings shall thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid of the terror by night. How many of you are afraid of the dark? How many of you sleep with the night light? Don't put your hand up. But some people, they're afraid of the dark. Not only children, but people just afraid of the dark. And for a long time, as a young man, I was afraid of the dark. And usually, so happened that in our basement, where the wash machine was, it was a wash machine. You would put your clothes in, it would go, pick, 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 pick. On the end of it was a ringer, and you'd put your clothes through the ringer. This is a long time ago. But sometimes my mother would be down there doing the laundry, and she'd leave the light on. Now, we didn't have switches, we were poor, but there was a cord, and you'd pull that and turn the light off. And one time my sweet mother took me and my sister to a scary movie. Scary movie. I don't know about you, but I have an imagination. And in that movie, it was called The House of Wax. And if you saw the movie, it was back in 1922, I think. But if you saw the movie, the wax figures began to melt. And then there was a person that walked. So go down, turn the light off, Dan. Then go down, turn the light off, Des. Okay. So I went down there, and being short, finally I got it off, and I turned around. You get the idea. So I'm not afraid of the dark. I keep telling myself. And so just little things like that. God is so tender and so wonderful that he protects us even from the night. Thou should not be afraid of the terror of night. You don't know what's happening in nighttime because it's night. For the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor to destruction that wasteth at thy noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thy eyes shall thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. Now, I want you to find the second to the last book of the Bible. Just a little bitty book, but a wonderful book. It's called the Book of Jude, written by one of our Lord's half-brothers, Jude. James, written by one of our Lord's others, half-brothers. Remember, the Lord had five brothers. So I find no fault in his blood. I find no fault in his book. But you know what? The Bible says that offenses will come in our lives. People will offend us. We'll be offended towards them, offensive. And some people are prickly people. I try not to be prickly, but sometimes I find myself prickly. And I offend people. I do my best to pray the psalm, let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And I say, Lord, help me not say anything stupid today. Help me not to be offensive today. And then the conversation begins, and what happens? I change my shoe sizes, open mouth, stick in foot. So here's something that I believe if we walk faithfully with the Lord, if we're faithful in prayer, if we're faithful in worship, if we're faithful to the house of God, if we're faithful trusting His salvation, trusting His word, witnessing for Him, worshiping Him, sharing our wealth back with Him, then here's the promise that I want to leave you with this morning. Jude, verse number 24. Now unto him that is able to keep you from what? Oh, we fall, but we get back up. A just man falleth 7 times, but he gets back up. To present you how? Faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen. Now unto him that's able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Shall we stand together? Shall we stand together? Our heads are bowed. Our eyes are closed. To keep us faultless, keep us from falling, to present us faultless. Our heads are bowed. The pianist is coming. And I would ask you a couple questions this morning. First of all, do you find fault in his salvation? The list is gone, Lene. Oh, here it is. Do you find fault with his salvation? Do you find fault with his scriptures? By the way, tonight I'll finish this message. Finding fault in his salvation. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none under name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Do you find fault in his salvation? Do you find fault in his scripture? Do you find fault in his service, serving the Lord? Do you find fault in his supplies? Do you find fault in his security? Thank God, the twice born child of God shall never go to hell. For we have eternal life, everlasting life, by his precious blood. While our heads are bowed and eyes are closed, I wonder, I can look at you, but I can't see your heart, but he does. And I wonder how many this morning would say, preacher, remember me in closing prayer this morning. It's not that I have found fault in Jesus, but this morning I found fault in my religion. I realize my religion can't save me. My religion won't take me to heaven. Would you pray for me in the matter of salvation this morning, preacher? I'm not sure if I died today, I'd go to heaven. Would you pray for me? Is there one like that? Raise that hand, I'll see it. I'll pray for you, and you can be sure of going to heaven when you die by trusting Jesus as your Savior. Yes, I see that hand. You may take it down. You may take it down. Someone else, I have religion, but I don't have God's righteousness. Preacher, would you pray for me in the matter of salvation? I need to be saved. Would you please remember me in closing prayer? Now, there was a time in my life and a place in my life when I turned from my self-righteousness and I embraced Jesus as my Savior. If I die this 192nd day of 2022, better known as July 10th, I know I'm going to heaven, not being presumptuous, not being arrogant, but Jesus is my Savior. And my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life and Glory. Here's my hand as a testimony. I'm saved. I know when I die, I'm going to heaven. I know that for sure. Thank you. You may take it down. Now I wonder about your life as a Christian. How is your walk with the Savior? I tell you, it takes a tall order to walk and follow Jesus. Peter stepped away. Judas denied him. And all the apostles, save young John, the teenager, forsook him and fled, except John. John lived to be the oldest apostle, wrote 5 books of the Bible, wrote the final book of the Bible, the book of the Revelation. Preacher, would you pray for me this morning? There are some areas of my life as a Christian that I'm struggling with. Would you pray for me this morning? Would you pray for me? Some areas that I'm struggling with. Thank you. You may take them down. And Father, how you love us is uncomprehendable, unexpressible, unexplainable that you love us. Oh God, how Satan has dealt to us a bunch of lies. And sometimes we feel so insecure. We feel so inadequate to live the Christian life because we cannot without the power of the Holy Spirit. And Lord, because of that big chunk, when a preacher, well-meaning, would say, you need to read your Bible, well, where do I read? Where do I read? Oh God, help us to take a portion of the Word of God. Some precious young lady said to me in recent days, I'm reading in the book of Psalms. What a blessing that is. If Psalms deals with every emotion we can experience, to be sure, we need the book of Psalms. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I may not sin against thee. Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto, according to thy word. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. God, help us to be Bible people. In these days of decline, these days of declension, these days of doubt and discouragement, these days of dismay, to be sure, every day the media, the government, religion are throwing so many things and coming so rapidly at us that, Lord, sometimes and more often than not, we're overwhelmed. But, oh God, which time we're overwhelmed, we need to come to our hiding place, come to our refuge, come to our rock, come to our sustainer, come to our Heavenly Father. Help us to do that. Help that to become so much a part of our lives that all through the day we keep in touch and keep short accounts. For when we sin, and we do, if we confess our sin, oh God, how stubborn we are, how rebellious we are and disobedient to want to live in our sin that we know is displeasing to you. God, have mercy. God, have mercy. But if we walk in the light as he's in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. And I praise you and thank you for that. Thank you for that precious verse. If we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Pray you bless this invitation, dear God. I pray thy people, those who know thee as Savior, would take care of some matters this morning that has caused them to slip away from your best, from your perfect will. Those, Lord, struggling with sin. We all struggle with sin. We'd be a liar. I'd be a liar to say that sin does not tempt me every day, all through the day. But Lord, as a child of God, we have a choice to yield to thy Spirit and not to Satan. Bless this invitation, I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. We're singing number 270. And I like this song because it says, just as you are. Would you come this morning? God spoke in your heart. You're struggling with something in your life. Maybe you find fault in Christianity and Christ because of some doubt. Come this morning. Get things settled.
Just as I am without but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou biddest me come to thee, O Lamb.
Maybe some young person needs to come to the second one.
Just as I am and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blood, to thee,
listen,
can cleanse.
Oh, how young people need to live for the Lord. And thank you who are living for the Lord as young people, being faithful to him, being Daniel, being daring to be an Esther, a Mary, a Martha.
Tossed about with many of conflict, many of doubt, fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb.
He makes it so simple. Just come, come to Jesus.
Just as I am, poor wretched blind, sight riches healing of.
Listen to this. If you come, what's he going to do for you?
Just as I am, thou wilt receive, will welcome.
Why is that? Seated, and the men are going to come now and wait on you for morning offering. You may be seated.